Penguin Random House Audio presents Weapons of Math Destruction: How Big Data Increases Inequality and Threatens Democracy. This is the author, Cathy O'Neill. Introduction. When I was a little girl, I used to gaze at the traffic out the car window and study the numbers on license plates. I would reduce each one to its basic elements, the prime numbers that made it up. 45 equals 3 times 3 times 5. That's called factoring, and it was my favorite investigative pastime. As a budding math nerd, I was especially intrigued by the primes. My love for math eventually became a passion. I went to math camp when I was 14 and came home clutching a Rubik's Cube to my chest. Math provided a neat refuge from the messiness of the real world. It marched forward, its field of knowledge expanding relentlessly, proof by proof. And I could add to it. I majored in math in college and went on to get my PhD. My thesis was on algebraic number theory, a field with roots in all that factoring I did as a child. Eventually, I became a tenure-track professor at Barnard, which had a combined math department with Columbia University. And then I made a big change. I quit my job and went to work as a quant for D.E. Shaw, a leading hedge fund. In leaving academia for finance, I carried mathematics from abstract theory into practice. The operations we performed on numbers translated into trillions of dollars sloshing from one account to another. At first, I was excited and amazed by working in this new laboratory, the global economy. But in the autumn of 2008, after I'd been there for a bit more than a year, it came crashing down. The crash made it all too clear that mathematics, once my refuge, was not only deeply entangled in the world's problems, but also fueling many of them. The housing crisis, the collapse of major financial institutions, the rise of unemployment, all had been aided and abetted by mathematicians wielding magic formulas. What's more, thanks to the extraordinary powers that I love so much, math was able to combine with technology to multiply the chaos and misfortune, adding efficiency and scale to systems that I now recognized as flawed. If we had been clear-headed, we all would have taken a step back at this point to figure out how math had been misused and how we could prevent a similar catastrophe in the future. But instead, in the wake of the crisis, new mathematical techniques were hotter than ever and expanding into still more domains. They churned 24/7 through petabytes of information, much of it scraped from social media or e-commerce websites. And increasingly, they focused not on the movements of global financial markets, but on human beings, on us. Mathematicians and statisticians were studying our desires, movements, and spending power. They were predicting our trustworthiness and calculating our potential as students, workers, lovers, criminals. This was the big data economy, and it promised spectacular gains. A computer program could speed through thousands of resumes or loan applications in a second or two and sort them into neat lists, with the most promising candidates on top. This not only saved time, but also was marketed as fair and objective. After all, it didn't involve prejudiced human beings digging through reams of paper, just machines processing cold numbers. By 2010 or so, mathematics was asserting itself as never before in human affairs, and the public largely welcomed it. Yet, I saw trouble. The math-powered applications powering the data economy were based on choices made by fallible human beings. Some of these choices were no doubt made with the best intentions. Nevertheless, many of these models encoded human prejudice, misunderstanding, and bias into the software systems that increasingly managed our lives. Like gods, these mathematical models were opaque, their workings invisible to all but the highest priests in their domain, mathematicians and computer scientists. Their verdicts, even when wrong or harmful, were beyond dispute or appeal. And they tended to punish the poor and the oppressed in our society while making the rich richer. I came up with a name for these harmful kinds of models, weapons of math destruction, or WMDs for short. I'll walk you through an example, pointing out its destructive characteristics along the way. As often happens, this case started with a laudable goal. In 2007, Washington, D.C.'s new mayor, Adrian Fenty, was determined to turn around the city's underperforming schools. He had his work cut out for him. At the time, barely one out of every two high school students were surviving to graduation after ninth grade, and only 8% of eighth graders were performing at grade level in math. Fenty hired an education reformer named Michelle Rhee to fill a powerful new post, Chancellor of Washington Schools. The going theory was that the students weren't learning enough because their teachers weren't doing a good job. So in 2009, Rhee implemented a plan to weed out the low-performing teachers. This is a trend in troubled school districts around the country. And from a systems engineering perspective, the thinking makes perfect sense. Evaluate the teachers, get rid of the worst ones, and place the best ones where they can do the most good. In the language of data scientists, this optimizes the school system, presumably ensuring better results for the kids. Except for bad teachers, who could argue with that? We developed a teacher assessment tool called Impact, and at the end of the 2009-2010 school year, the district fired all the teachers whose scores put them in the bottom 2%. At the end of the following year, another 5%, or 206 teachers, were booted out. Sarah Wasaki, a fifth-grade teacher, didn't seem to have any reason to worry. She had been at McFarland Middle School for only 2 years, but was already getting excellent reviews from her principal and her students' parents. One evaluation praised her attentiveness to the children. Another called her, quote, one of the best teachers I've ever come into contact with, unquote. Yet, at the end of the 2010-2011 school year, Wasaki received a miserable score on her impact evaluation. Her problem was a new scoring system known as value-added modeling, which purported to measure her effectiveness in teaching math and language skills. That score, generated by an algorithm, represented half her overall evaluation, and it outweighed the positive reviews from school administrators and the community. This left the district with no choice but to fire her, along with 205 other teachers who had impact scores below the minimal threshold. This didn't seem to be a witch hunt or a settling of scores. Indeed, there's a logic to the school district's approach. Administrators, after all, could be friends with terrible teachers. They could admire their style or their apparent dedication. Bad teachers can seem good. So Washington, like many other school systems, would minimize this human bias and pay more attention to scores based on hard results, achievement scores in math and reading. The numbers would speak clearly, district officials promised. They would be more fair. Wasaki, of course, felt the numbers were horribly unfair, and she wanted to know where they came from. I don't think anyone understood them, she later told me. How could a good teacher get such dismal scores? What was the value-added model measuring? Well, she learned, it was complicated. The district had hired a consultancy, Princeton-based Mathematica Policy Research, to come up with the evaluation system. Mathematica's challenge was to measure the educational progress of the students in the district and then to calculate how much of their advance or decline could be attributed to their teachers. This wasn't easy, of course. The researchers knew that many variables, from students' socioeconomic backgrounds to the effects of learning disabilities, could affect student outcomes. The algorithms had to make allowances for such differences, which was one reason they were so complex. Indeed, attempting to reduce human behavior, performance, and potential to algorithms is no easy job. To understand what Mathematica was up against, picture a 10-year-old girl living in a poor neighborhood in southeastern Washington, D.C. At the end of one school year, she takes her fifth-grade standardized test. Then life goes on. She may have family issues or money problems. Maybe she's moving from one house to another or worried about an older brother who's in trouble with the law. Maybe she's unhappy about her weight or frightened by a bully at school. In any case, the following year she takes another standardized test, this one designed for sixth graders. If you compare the results of the tests, the scores should stay stable or hopefully jump up. But if her results sink, it's easy to calculate the gap between her performance and that of the successful students. But how much of that gap is due to her teacher? It's hard to know. And Mathematica's models have only a few numbers to compare. At big data companies like Google, by contrast, researchers run constant tests and monitor thousands of variables. They can change the font on a single advertisement from blue to red, serve each version to 10 million people, and keep track of which one gets more clicks. They use this feedback to hone their algorithms and fine-tune their operation. While I have plenty of issues with Google, which we'll get to, this type of testing is an effective use of statistics. Attempting to calculate the impact that one person may have on another over the course of a school year is much more complex. There are so many factors that go into learning and teaching that it would be very difficult to measure them all, Wasaki says. What's more, attempting to score a teacher's effectiveness by analyzing the test results of only 25 or 30 students is statistically unsound, even laughable. The numbers are far too small given all the things that could go wrong. Indeed, if we were to analyze teachers with the statistical rigor of a search engine, we'd have to test them on thousands or even millions of randomly selected students. Statisticians count on large numbers to balance out exceptions and anomalies. And WMDs, as we'll see, often punish individuals who happen to be the exception. Equally important, statistical systems require feedback, something to tell them when they're off track. Statisticians use errors to train their models and make them smarter. If Amazon.com...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.